The personal computer has become the most ubiquitous machine in modern times. This machine was once a luxury, where only big business and scientific institutions had any use for them. Today, however, the computer has worked its way into the homes of the average person. Despite this, most users are secretly terrified of the computer. Countless individuals leave even the most simple and trivial computer problems to experts who charge handsome fees for minor fixes. The purpose of this video is to teach the common computer user how to operate and maintain their computer, along with general tips for troubleshooting common computer problems. So, sit back and let us teach you how to maintain and operate your personal computer. First, let's quickly examine the components that comprise the typical PC. The external parts of the computer are the keyboard, mouse, and monitor. Most people are familiar with these parts because these are the input and output devices we use to communicate with the computer. But inside the computer tend to be less familiar parts. Let's start off with the processor. The purpose of the processor is to process information. It is the brain of the computer. The processor always has a fan and heat sink. The purpose of this combination is to keep the processor cool enough to operate. The heat sink often looks like a metal porcupine and is made of aluminum or copper. The average computer contains at least 3 fans, and one of these fans is dedicated to the processor. The other 2 fans are used to move hot air out of your computer case and power supply. Next, you have the RAM memory. RAM stands for Random Access Memory. RAM is a temporary form of memory, which means all of the information stored in RAM memory will be lost once the computer is shut down. This is the hard drive. This is the computer's permanent memory, so it does not lose the data recorded on it when the computer is powered down, unlike RAM. The hard drive can also store hundreds of times more data than RAM. It is this device that contains your personal files and software that you use every day. Then there's the motherboard. This is often a huge circuit with chips, plugs, and wires. The motherboard is the heart of the computer, since its purpose is to bring all of the separate components into a single functioning computer. To find the motherboard, simply locate the RAM and processor, which directly plug in to the motherboard. Next is the video card, or graphics card. This card receives information from the motherboard and converts it to color data that is eventually sent to your monitor. Many computers have onboard video cards, which means that the graphics unit comes as part of the motherboard rather than a separate card in one of the card slots. The video card may have a standard video plug or an HD video plug. Here is the sound card. The sound card controls the computer's audio input and output. On the card's front, you will find many colored headphone jacks. The 2 main plugs of concern are pink and green. Pink is where a microphone is plugged into, while speakers are plugged into light green jacks. Like the video card, the audio unit has also been built in to some motherboards. Next, we have what is called the power supply. The function of the power supply is to convert the voltage coming from the wall socket to something closer to the needs of the computer. It is easily identified by its dedicated fans and many wires. Here is the optical drive, which is usually a DVD player. Many computers these days have DVD players that can also create DVDs. To burn a DVD is to record data onto a DVD disc. And if your drive is capable of writing onto DVDs, you will find words like rewritable, RW, and recorder on the front panel of the DVD drive. On the outside of the computer's case, you will find a number of different plugs. The most common socket is called a USB socket. These USB sockets have become the standard plug that computers use to communicate to peripheral devices like cameras, internet, iPods, and even keyboards. Other sockets often found on the outside of the computer are the keyboard and mouse plugs. These 2 plugs have long been used to connect keyboards and mice to the computer, but they are slowly being phased out with USB keyboards and mice. The last 2 commonly seen jacks are phone and Ethernet ports. The 2 telephone jacks, which belong to the telephone modem, uses the telephone to connect to the internet. One of the jacks, usually labeled wall or line, should be plugged into the phone jack in the wall, while the modem's other phone jack, labeled phone, is connected to a telephone. The use of phone modems to connect to the internet has certainly declined in recent years. The next plug of interest is the Ethernet plug, which often looks like a wider version of the phone jack. The plug is used to connect to high-speed internet. Often, your internet service provider will give you a high-speed modem designed to plug in to the Ethernet port. On the front of your computer, one may find many plugs of various sizes. These are memory card slots designed for the memory cards used in many devices, like cameras. Now that you know its parts, let's begin. The most basic unit of storage in the world of computers is called the file. A computer file may contain any kind of information, such as music, video games, text, and movies. The average computer contains thousands of computer files. Some are small, some are large, some are trivial, and some are vital. Each file has a name, and this is called the file name. Each file name has two parts, which are divided by a period. The first part is the file's main title, while the second part of the file name, which is called the file extension, describes what kind of information the file contains. For instance, MP3 is certainly the most famous file extension. An MP3 is a kind of computer file that contains high-quality audio and is widely used in portable devices like iPods. The main title of an MP3 file usually contains the author and song name, while the extension is always MP3. There are many different types of file extensions, but commonly encountered extensions are EXE, MP3, JPEG, ZIP, TXT, and AVI. EXE is a software extension and means that this file is a computer program, like a browser or a video game. JPEG is a commonly used format for images. ZIP files are compressed packages that themselves can contain many smaller files. TXT stands for text and therefore indicates that the file contains text. AVI is a common extension for movies. Computer files come in all different sizes. Some files, like AVI files, are large because computer files containing movies tend to be large. Other files, like the TXT files, which contain only text, tend to be small. File sizes and everything else in the computer world are measured in bytes. The byte represents a single basic unit of digital storage. The sizes of files tends to be displayed using notation rather than the whole number. The number of bytes are often listed as a small number paired together with a capital letter. The capitalized letter on the right denotes the size of the units, while the number on the left describes how many units. Let me explain. And pay attention carefully, because this is important. Listed on the screen is a series of capitalized letters and the amount they denote. K is for kilo, which means 1,000. M is for mega, and means 1 million. G is for giga, and equals 1 billion. And T is for tera, and denotes 1 trillion. So, if you're perusing the internet and are about to download an MP3 file that says 5.5M or 5.5MB, you know that this file is 5.5 million bytes in size. If a file on your computer says 300K or 300KB, then that file is 300,000 bytes in size. If you're buying a new hard drive and one catches your eye that says 500 GB, it means that the hard drive can store 500 billion bytes. But a hard drive which reads 1T or 1TB has twice as much space as a 500 gigabyte hard drive because it can store 1 trillion bytes. Everything in the computer world uses this system of measurement. Sometimes you will see the letters PS behind the capital letter. The PS stands for per second, and so is used to describe how fast data is transferred. So for example, a computer file that is 1 megabyte will take 1 second to send if transferred at a speed of 1 megabyte per second. Large numbers of computer files are stored and organized into folders, which are also called directories. A computer's file system may be thought of as a tree, where the leaves represent computer files and the limbs represent the folders. Beginning at the base of a tree, an ant may crawl and eventually reach any leaf he wishes as long as he takes the correct path up the limbs of the tree. Equally, you may arrive at any file in your computer as long as you take the right path. The root of the computer's file system, which would represent the trunk of my metaphorical tree, is often called My Computer. The My Computer icon, which sometimes just says computer, is often found on the desktop or in the Start button. The desktop is the background screen, which usually has a fancy picture and is populated with icons. It is important that you locate the My Computer icon before we continue. It may also be necessary to locate a button named Organize, from which you may make the menu bar visible. Also, if the extensions of files aren't visible in your My Computer window, go to Tools and Folder Options. In the View tab, you'll find Hide Extensions for Known File Types. Make sure this is unchecked. Upon clicking on the My Computer icon, you will see the list of drives attached to your computer. Each of these drives is represented by a letter, and the most frequently encountered drives are C, D, E, and F. The drive most relevant to us is the C drive. The C drive is our main focus because it allows access to the computer's primary hard drive. Other drives you will see in the My Computer window are recovery drives, CD and DVD drives, and other devices plugged into the computer. Often, when a camera or MP3 player, for instance, is plugged into the computer via a USB wire, the device will appear as a drive. Every drive is assigned a letter, and all the letters above C are usually devoted to extra internal hard drives, DVD players, and external devices like cameras. If we click on the C drive, which may be titled Local Disk, we'll see a set of folders with various files below them. The folders, which you will see at the top of the window, offer us a way to organize information. Imagine if every file on your computer were in the same place on the same list. Finding pictures of last summer's vacation in the midst of thousands of files would be tedious. Fortunately, we have a way to organize our files so that our homework, music, and vacation photos can be in separate places. Inside of the folders, you will find files and other folders. Everyone has a different file structure on their computer, but of all the folders shown, program files, users, and windows are present in virtually all computers. Every file and folder has what is called a path. The first part of the path is the drive letter, followed by a colon. The second part is the folder path, and the third part is the file name. Here is an example file path. First, you have the drive letter. The letter C tells us that the file is on the hard drive. The folder path indicates that the file we seek is in a folder called Windows, and in another folder called System32. The third part of our example path shows us that the file's name is msconfig.exe. So, in order to find the file listed above, first, open up My Computer, then C drive, then open up the Windows folder, then the System32 folder, then locate the file msconfig.exe. As you can see, there are many other files in the System32 folder. The one we are looking for is named msconfig.exe. We will find it among all the other files whose names begin with M. If we open up the file's properties, we can see details regarding this file. First, it tells you that this file is an application which is software, like a spreadsheet or video game. Looking at the file's location, we see the drive letter and folder path we used. Below the file's location, we see the file size given in the notation explained previously, 222 KB or 222,000 bytes. And below, it says that this file was created January 20th, 2008. Let's try something else. I have a bunch of photos on my camera and want to view them. First, I plug the camera in. After doing so, I see the camera appear in the My Computer window listed as removable disk and was assigned the drive letter I. I go into the root folder of my camera, but don't find enough items to possibly be my photos. Instead, I find a folder named DCIM, but after going into the DCIM folder, I still find no photos, only another folder named 100 Media. Ah, here are my photos. It's also worth noting that file names and paths are not case sensitive. Files and folders can also be created, manipulated, and deleted by the user. First, let's create a folder. Go to My Computer, then C Drive, then go to File, then New, and then Folder. It will create a new folder and name it New Folder. You may also right-click on an empty part of the My Computer window and select New and Folder. Folder names should not be too long, should include mainly letters and numbers, and should in some way describe the folder's content. Therefore, I should change New Folder to something more descriptive of the folder's would-be content. So, let's rename it. Click on the newly created folder and go up to File and then Rename. Let's type Camera Photo. Entering the folder, predictably, we find no files or folders. Let's create another folder. After all, I don't want every photo this camera takes saved in the same place. I'll name this new folder Summer 2010. Here we are, the perfect place to store the photos from last summer. But the folder is empty and all the photos are still on the camera, you say? Sure, but copying the files is easy. First, we open up another My Computer window. Then we find the iDrive, because this is the drive assigned to my camera. From here, waltz through the camera's folders until we find my photos. If you left-click on an empty point on the My Computer window and hold the mouse button, you'll notice a colored box is formed. This colored box can be used to select files. So, let's select all of my photo files and go to Edit and Copy. This tells the computer that I'm preparing to copy the files I've just selected to another location. Now, I go to the folder that I created on my computer, the folder I made to store last summer's photos. I then go to Edit and Paste. If I wanted to remove the photos off my camera, I return to the window that's viewing my camera photos, and I once again select all the files. And go to File, and then Delete. There is even an easier way of copying and deleting the originals. By selecting the files in the same manner, one may go to Edit and Cut, then go to Edit and Paste in the target folder. Using Cut instead of Copy will delete the original and essentially move the file. An easier way of selecting all of the files in a window is to go to Edit and select all. Windows has a feature called drag and drop. This allows people to drag objects, like files, from one location to another. Using drag and drop, we may achieve the same thing as going to Edit, Cut, and Edit, Paste. Let's try copying the files on my camera to the Summer 2010 folder on my computer using the drag and drop method. First, I ensure that both the source folder and the target folder are both on the screen simultaneously. I select the image files in the camera, then I left-click on one of the files. While holding down the left mouse button, bring the mouse cursor over the target window, the summer 2010 folder. The files now begin copying to your hard drive. Many programs out there support drag and drop. Not only can we create folders and move files into them, but we may also change the way the files are displayed and in what order they're displayed in. In the View menu, you may change the size of the icons, which allows us to see the image in the computer file. Go into the View menu once more and select Details. The Details View mode allows you to not only see the file name, but various details regarding the file. We may also choose how the files are sorted. Let's begin with the details themselves. You will usually see details like name, date, size, and type. In order to add or remove details, right-click on the top row of the Details window. You will see check marks beside details that are in view. Check or uncheck the details according to your wishes. Me, I have no need for a date taken, ratings, or tags column, so I uncheck them. I do like having a size, type, and date created column, however. Sometimes you have to open the extended list for all of your options. In this view, we can see the file name, the size of the file, the type of the file, and the date the file was created. These columns can be dragged around using the drag and drop method. It's also worth noting that open and save dialog windows use the same system as the My Computer window. Most of the time, the files are sorted by file name, which means that they are displayed in alphabetical order, but sometimes it's useful to see the list of files sorted in another way. Suppose, for instance, you've been saving files in a particular folder for weeks and want to locate the very last file you saved there. As long as you have a date created or date modified column, simply click on it. You will now see a small triangle inside the date column, indicating the files are now sorted by date. An easier way to change the way files are sorted is to go to View and then Sort. If you need to locate a file on your computer, you can search for the file using the search tool. Simply click the Start button and go to Search. Next, find Files and Folders. Say you downloaded the song Enter the Sandman by the band Metallica, but simply can't find where the file went. Type in Metallica or Sandman into the search text box and hit Enter. The search tool now begins searching the computer for all the files whose names have Metallica or Sandman in it. A boot, or a boot up, is when a computer turns on and loads for the first time. During boot up, a large number of computer programs are also started. Much of this software is necessary to the Windows operating system and drivers for devices attached to the computer. A driver is a program that acts as an intermediary between the computer and a device attached to it. Many of the devices attached to your computer, such as video cards, webcams, and printers, require drivers to operate. If you have a printer, for instance, the drivers for that printer are loaded during boot up. There are, however, many programs loaded by Windows that aren't necessary, and this unnecessary software is the primary cause of computer slowdown. In order to modify which programs are started when the computer first boots up, click the Start button, then Run. In the text box, type msconfig. A window named System Configuration appears with a number of tabs on the top. The two tabs of importance are Services and Startup. Let's begin with the Startup tab. Take a look at the items that are checked. Each of these checked items is a program that is executed the moment Windows is loaded. The programs usually continue running throughout the duration of your computing experience. Many of these programs are unnecessary, and therefore only cause the computer to slow down. A checked program that is not associated with a device on your computer, such as a printer, video card, or webcam, is the first sign of an unnecessary startup program. Look at the column that says Manufacturer and see whether that program says Lexmark or Logitech, because if you so happen to own a Lexmark printer or a Logitech webcam, you may want to keep it checked. If you expand the command column, you'll see the full path and actual file name of the startup program. If you wanted to know what justshed.exe is and whether or not you need it to execute during computer startup, simply go to Google and type it in. Type justshed.exe. Often you will find a host of people who are asking about the same file, and often their questions have been answered. In this case, it turns out that justshed.exe is an unnecessary Java updating program. Many programs, especially those involving media like photos, movies, and music, tend to set themselves as one of the startup programs. Even though you may use that software often, there's no need for these kinds of programs to be in the startup list. And now, onto the Services tab. The items in the Services tab is another list of programs that get executed when the computer first starts up, and they too can slow down your computer. On the screen is a list of common Windows services, together with their priority rating and brief function description. Services with 3 stars are recommended and are usually quite vital. Services with 2 stars may be required by particular users who own certain devices or frequently use certain software, but for most users, a 2-star service is also optional. Services with 1 star are very optional and are only required in the rarest cases. These 1-star services can be disabled without much concern. If you discover you've disabled a service that is vital to you, simply re-enable a few services that might be associated with the problem. If you're without that kind of patience, simply click Enable All. If there's a service on your list that isn't on mine, type in the service's name into Google and find out what its function is and whether it is necessary. The changes you make using msconfig will not go into effect until the computer is restarted. The majority of settings that the common Windows user needs can be found in the Control Panel. To open the Control Panel, click the Start button, then Settings, then Control Panel. My Control Panel is in the Classic view. The first item of interest is Programs and Features, sometimes called Add Remove Programs. Even though many software packages include a dedicated uninstall feature, the Control Panel is another convenient way of uninstalling software. This is a good place to start in regards to cleaning up your computer. Remove programs you don't use or don't use anymore. And lastly, we return to the Control Panel so that we may change the setting of our Windows user account. In an application named User Accounts, one may add, modify, or remove a password for the account. You may also change your account permission. For instance, if you want to change the password to your Windows account, click Change Password. Here, you will be asked to enter the account's current password, then type and retype the new password. If you wish to remove your password so that you may log on to Windows without typing a password at all, click Remove Password. If you want to change the account type from Standard to Administrator, click Change Type. The difference between standard permissions and administrator permissions is that administrators can make almost any change to the computer and its settings, whereas a standard account has permissions fitting for your children or employees. If you're the computer's sole user, it is important that your account is administrator. Video comes up often in modern computing. Often we are inclined at some point or another to watch a video or listen to a song we've downloaded. Well, In order to play videos on your computer, you need two things. The first is a media player, like Windows Media Player, which come loaded with Windows. And the second thing you need are called codecs. Codecs are programs that plug into the media player and permit the viewing of a particular kind of video file. You'll find many different types of video files while surfing the internet. The main video formats have extensions like AVI, MPG, WMV, MP4, and FLV. Codecs also tend to be completely free and are usually downloaded in packages. An excellent website for downloading free codecs is freecodecs.com. Here, the K-Lite codec can be downloaded. K-Lite is an excellent codec package and is updated regularly. Adobe Flash Player, available at adobe.com, is a plugin often required to view streaming video on the internet. Next, we'll learn how to burn DVDs. To burn a DVD is to record something onto the DVD. Most computers these days come loaded with DVD rewritable drive. There are many ways and many programs which create DVDs. The easiest way is to insert a blank DVD into the DVD drive. Then, go to My Computer and attempt to open the DVD drive. Usually, a window appears asking for the title you want to give to the DVD. Give the DVD a name of reasonable length. Then click Show Formatting Options and select Mastered File System or Live File System. I recommend Mastered File System. After all of this, you're given a blank window, and it is to this blank window where you paste all of the files you intend to record onto DVD. Recording information onto a blank CD is done exactly the same. The DVD has a storage capacity of 4.3 gigabytes, while the CD has a capacity of only 700 megabytes. Retrieving the total file size of many files is easy. Simply select all of the files, right-click on one of those files, and then click Properties. A window appears telling me that I have selected 8 files, and that the total file size is 5.3 gigabytes. Since I'm trying to burn a DVD, and since DVDs only have a capacity of 4.3 gigabytes, it's obvious that I'll be forced to remove some of the files so that their total size of all of the files is less than 4.3 gigabytes. So, I begin selecting and removing files until all of the files can fit onto a single DVD. Once that's done, click Burn to Disk or Close Session. Burn speeds of 4x to 8x produce high-quality DVDs, whereas burning a DVD at 16x will certainly be faster, but will produce a slightly less reliable recording. It is also worth noting that cleaning CDs and DVDs before putting them into the drive increases the drive's speed, reliability, and lifespan. So, whether you're reading the disk or writing to a disk, remember to clean the bottoms first. This is especially true with blank disks you're about to record to. Before inserting the blank disk into the DVD drive, minimize the number of smudges and fibers from the bottom of the disk. Even though you may use My Computer to burn DVDs, there are programs out there that make burning DVDs easier. One of those programs that makes disk burning easier, and is also completely free, is called Image Burn. Image Burn has a number of options, but the one that concerns us is write files and folders. Ensure that the destination is set to the DVD drive with the empty DVD in it. My DVD burner, for instance, is the G drive. On the bottom of the Image Burn window, you'll see the drive's status. If you have an empty DVD in the disk drive, it will say ready. Otherwise, it may say that the DVD drive has no disk at all, or perhaps a disk that has already been written to. Clicking on Show Disk Layout Editor, a large window appears. This window, called the Disk Layout Editor, is what we will use to add files to the empty DVD. As with many other programs, Image Burn supports drag and drop. so finding and adding files to the DVD becomes a cinch. After clicking on computer, the interface becomes very familiar. Now, it's a simple matter of locating the files on my hard drive, the ones that I wish to burn to DVD. Once found, they can be copied and pasted, or simply drag and drop onto the empty window below. This window represents the files that are soon to be on the DVD. On the bottom right of the screen, you'll see an option to change what kind of disk you're burning. If you're burning a CD, change this to 700 megabyte CD. If you're burning a DVD, change this setting to DVD-5. On the bottom of the window, you'll discover a blue bar making its way from left to right. This blue bar indicates how much of the disk will be filled by the files you've selected. After you've selected too many files, this bar will turn red. At this point, some files must be removed in order to continue. Once the selected files fit within the confines of DVD capacity, which is 4.3 gigabytes, you are ready to create the disk. Close out the editor window and open up the device tab. An ideal setting for speed is 8x, and in the options tab, you'll find a file system setting. An ideal selection is ISO 9660 plus UDF. Under the labels tab, one may assign a name to the disk. By clicking on an unlabeled icon below, the disk burning process is started. BitTorrent has quickly become the internet standard in regards to downloading movies, music, TV shows, and software. This revolutionary system allows regular computer users to share files and folders with each other without the need for a website. The first thing you need to begin downloading from BitTorrent is what is called a BitTorrent client. There are many BitTorrent client programs out there, and almost all of them are completely free. But the one I recommend is uTorrent. Now that we have downloaded a client program, we can now go find things to download. In order to search for files to download, we need to go to BitTorrent search engine sites. Simply typing in BitTorrent search into Google brings up a ton of sites which claim to be BitTorrent search sites. My favorite is thepiratebay.org. The search interface is pretty straightforward. Here, I type in what I'm looking for, then I specify what kind of search results I'm looking for. If I'm looking for music, I select music. If I'm looking for movies or TV shows, I search for video. If I'm looking for video games and other software, I select application or video game. Let's say I'm looking for videos. After finding the video and clicking on it, I'm brought to a screen with various information regarding this particular download. The first thing to take notice of is the size of the download, which is stated in the notation system discussed earlier. In this case, the download is 699 megabytes, or 699 million bytes in size. The second thing to take note of is the number of seeds and leeches, sometimes called seeds and peers. These two numbers comprise the number of people who are connected to that download. A seed is a user who has finished downloading and is now giving to others whose downloads are not yet finished, like you. A peer is a person who has not yet completed the download. Basically, until you're finished downloading, you're a peer. Never begin downloading from a torrent that has zero seeds. This means that not a single person connected to that torrent has a complete copy of the download. So therefore, it is unlikely your download will ever be complete. This particular download has 270 seeds and 53 peers. 270 is plenty of people to make for a quick download. In order to begin downloading, you must first download the torrent file associated with that torrent download. No matter what BitTorrent search site you end up at, the option to download the torrent will be present. A window will appear confirming that I want to download the torrent file. Many BitTorrent search sites allow the search results to be sorted by the number of seeds. This means that the first few search results listed are the most likely to download quick. An easy way to check many search sites is to type what you're looking for into Google together with the word torrent. This method works well for locating hard-to-find downloads. You may find yourself adding in a few extra details to narrow the search. It is important to note that this torrent file is not the video itself, but instead a small file which contains information regarding the video you intend to download, in this case, Casablanca. Agree to save or open the file. The small torrent file now appears in my downloads window. Attempt to open that download, and you'll discover that the BitTorrent client appears instead, and on the screen are the details of the files I'm attempting to download. When the arrow goes from pointing down to pointing up, it means that you're no longer downloading and that your download is complete and your movie is ready to watch. To find out where your movie is in the computer, simply find the setting that describes the download's target or destination folder. In Options, Preferences, and Directories, you'll find a setting called Put New Downloads In. This means that the movie I just downloaded can be found on the H drive, the Michael folder, and in the Downloads subfolder. Internet browsers like Firefox, Google Chrome, and Internet Explorer all have similar settings that allow you to see and change where the browser places new downloads. In the BitTorrent program, you'll find a similar grid of rows and columns that you saw in My Computer. And like the My Computer program, you can add, remove, sort, and alter the columns for ease of use. These kinds of grids are common throughout Windows. With BitTorrent, it is the columns that contain the name, seeds, tiers, size, up limit, down speed, and ETA which are most essential. The name is obviously the title of the download. The seeds is the number of people who have completed the download and are still connected. The peers is the number of people other than yourself who are downloading the same file you are. The size column shows how big the total download is. The up limit describes the maximum speed you are willing to give others. The down speed column shows how fast the download is streaming into your computer, while the ETA column shows an approximate time for completion. After a day or so of giving back to the BitTorrent community, simply remove the download. Removing the download off of the BitTorrent list does not remove the file from your computer. It simply disconnects you from the community of other people who are downloading the same file. A common misconception is that your computer can be infected with a virus by downloading the wrong video or audio file. This is simply not true. Audio and video is interpreted data, not executed data. You can be infected with virus-like software while at a torrent search site, but the music or movie itself cannot contain a virus. Downloading software and video games, however, can expose you to viruses. In order to burn DVDs that can be used in any common DVD player as opposed to computers only, your DVD must meet certain requirements. First, the DVD must be burned using the ISO 9660 plus UDF file format. Secondly, the video must be in true DVD format. Videos in true DVD format can be identified by the folder that says Video TS. Inside this folder, you'll find a series of files that begin with BTS. When purchasing blank DVDs, I recommend discs labeled DVD-R. Most movies on the net are not in DVD form, but downloads that already are in DVD form will usually be listed as such on the BitTorrent search site. Making copies of DVDs you already own can be tricky if it's under copyright protection, because Windows will not allow the copying of these kinds of DVDs. A program that decrypts the DVD is needed, and for this, a free program called DVD Decryptor is ideal. Simply enter in your DVD drive, and the target folder and begin decryption. For common computer users, the control button is probably the most neglected key on the keyboard. But this shouldn't be so. The control button can save the average user tons of time, no matter what program they're using. And, as with most things, a little practice is required, but you'll soon discover the control button pulling its weight. First, we'll review text editing. By holding down the control button and pressing the left button, the text cursor moves left by whole words instead of a single space. This makes returning to a misspelled word a couple of words back much easier than hitting the left button 20 times. Pressing the right arrow button does the same thing, but instead moves right. The control and combination moves the cursor to the bottom of the document. The control home combination moves to the beginning of the document. Each day, new software is created, and each day programs are changing how software operates. Luckily for us, almost all software out there has the exact same options. This means that memorizing certain key combinations can save you time no matter what kind of software you're using. First of the standard menu options is File. The File menu option is where documents or projects are opened, saved, or printed. New opens a new document, often closing the current document. The Save option saves the current file under the current name. The Save As option saves the current file, but indicates that you want to change its name or location. The Open option opens a new document or project. And Print is where the current document is sent to the printer. Notice the shortcut keys to the right of the options title. Control N for new, Control S for save, Control O for open, and Control P for print. In the next menu option, called Edit, we see Cut, Copy, Paste, Select All, Clear, Undo, and Find. The Cut option removes a currently selected text or object and readies it to be placed elsewhere. The Copy option copies the selected text, but does not remove it from the document. The Paste option places the copied text at the cursor location. If you recall, we copied, cut, and pasted from one folder to another. The Select All option simply selects all of the content in the current document. Clear removes whatever content is selected. And the Undo option undoes the last action taken in that program. The Find option is another common feature that allows you to find where certain words are located within the document. Please take note of the shortcut keys associated with each of the options. Control X for cut, Control C for copy, Control V for paste, Control A for select all, the Delete button for clear, Control Z for undo, and Control F for find. Shortcut keys for these options is worth memorizing because almost all programs have the exact same standard option. Whether it's a word processor, an image editor, a video editor, or a browser, it is likely to have options like New, Save, Save As, Open, Print, in the File menu. While the Edit menu typically has Cut, Copy, Paste, Clear, Select All, and Undo. So, instead of going to File Save in order to save the current document, simply hold down either control button and press the S key. If you want to cut the selected text and paste it elsewhere, simply press Control X, then Control V. If you make a mistake, first try to hit Control Z. The right mouse button is yet another neglected button. Right-clicking on objects and items gives us a host of options relating to the selected objects. For example, back in my computer, we may delete a selection of files by going to File, Delete. We may hit the Delete button on the keyboard, or we may right-click on the selected objects and go to Delete. To open a file, we may go to File, Open. We may press the Enter key, or we can right-click and select Open. You would be shocked how many objects in the computer have right-click menus where extra options can be accessed. If you want to do something with a particular item, but don't know how, first try looking for the option in the right-click menu. Another great and rarely used function of the control button involves selecting and deselecting items in a list. In all cases, to attempt to create a new selection will deselect whatever you have already selected. This can be a problem if you want to pick and choose which items are selected. But if you wanted to select only choice files, hold down the control button and begin clicking. And if you wanted to select all but a few files, hold down the control button while deselecting the items, and the remaining selected items will remain selected. There's a couple security issues that most computer users should be aware of. First is the use of a firewall. Firewalls are programs that prevent certain internet traffic and therefore protect you against hackers. Windows comes with a firewall program. A company called PC Tools makes an excellent firewall, and it's completely free. Another security issue involves viruses and spyware. A computer virus is a program that engages in some form of malicious activity on the PC. Some viruses monitor keystrokes, and these are called keyloggers. Their task is to record the keys you press and report them to a website or a server through the internet. These can be dangerous because they can easily expose personal information like passwords and credit card numbers to malicious people. Another type of virus is the Trojan. This type of virus gets its name from the Trojan horse story of Troy. The task of this type of malicious software is to open your computer to steal more viruses. Some viruses simply damage your files without performing any task for the virus maker. These are viruses born of pure maliciousness. They have no purpose other than to destroy. Some viruses are designed to hijack the browser and repeatedly expose the helpless computer user to advertisements. Often, the virus itself will advertise some no-name antivirus program. Some viruses monitor the websites you visit and report your net surfing to a computer who gathers advertising and demographics data. I recommend having two forms of protection. The first kind of protection is anti-spyware program to guard against spyware and adware. An excellent anti-spyware program is Spybot Search and Destroy, available at spybot.com. Doing a Spybot scan every month or so is a healthy thing. The second type of protection I recommend is antivirus software. In this, I mean true computer viruses. Two antivirus programs I recommend are AVG, available at avg.com, or Avast, available at avast.com. Unlike the spyware program, which can be used every 2 weeks or so, the antivirus program should always be active and running. Computer slowdown is easily the number one complaint I hear from common computer users. Aside from disabling the startup programs and services, there are other means to speed up your computer and your internet connection. On the inside of the computer, you may see the processor fan and heatsink covered with dust. This dust stops the processor from radiating the heat it creates. The processor's onboard thermostat senses the increase in temperature and begins to slow down the computer's operation until the processor cools down again. Because the processor cannot work while overheated, even a moderate layer of dust can result in 20% decrease in the computer's speed. Cans of pressurized air can be used to loosen the dust from the fan and heatsink. A vacuum cleaner with the proper attachments can also be used. If you've owned your computer for more than 9 months, you would do well to check how thick the dust has formed within the computer, especially if the air in your house tends to be dusty or laden with animal hair. Check other places in the computer for dust and use this opportunity to clean that dust as well. A well-ventilated computer is a cool computer, and a cool computer runs faster and lives longer than a computer that was forced to run warm. Another tip for speeding up the computer is a program that comes with Windows called Defragmenter. Defragmentation, or defrag for short, rearranges the files on your computer so that they can be read more efficiently. Defrag is usually found by hitting the Start button, Programs, Accessories, System Tools, and Disk Defragmenter. If your computer is experiencing slowdown, it is important to know the program and conditions which are responsible. If you find your computer acting up, press and hold the Control button, then the Alt button, then the Delete button all at the same time. You will either be brought to a window that says Task Manager or a screen with a series of options on it. One of those options should be Task Manager. You can also reach the Task Manager by clicking the Start button, then selecting Run and typing in Task MGR. The Task Manager is a program that allows you to view and terminate currently running software. In the Processes tab, you'll see a long list of programs currently running on your machine. You will also see two columns labeled CPU and Memory. The CPU column shows how much processor power a particular program is using. If you find a program that consistently hogs 60, 70, and 80% of your processing power, you may do well by selecting it on the list and ending the task. Go online and use the application's title to investigate whether other people out there are having the same issue. It may also be a good idea to find out whether the program is among your startup programs and disable it using msconfig. If the Windows operating system itself appears to be acting up, hit Ctrl-Alt-Delete and end any task named Explorer. Then, in the Applications tab, click the New Task button and type in Explorer. This will restart the Windows desktop. Nothing takes speed away from your favorite internet browser than toolbars and plugins. Often, the unwary computer user installs toolbars unknowingly. When installing software, the common user is likely to not read carefully exactly what they are agreeing to. So, when installing software for the first time, take note of the checkboxes. Rule of thumb, if there's a checkbox near it, then it's optional. By opening your browser and going to Tools, Manage Add-ons, you can add and remove programs that have attached themselves to your browser. But another method that's a bit riskier and only suitable for the most persistent add-ons is a program from Trend Micro called Hijack This. This program must be used with care, and with the help of Google to track down the function of certain plugins, your browser can be utterly cleaned of unwanted plugins and toolbars. Simply hit the Scan button, then check those items you wish removed, and hit Fix Check. Before you use Hijack This to remove browser clutter, first try to use the Add Remove program in the Control Panel or the Manage Add-ons menu of the Tools menu of your browser. Which brings us to Google as an excellent source for troubleshooting tips. This video could never cover all of the troubleshooting techniques and known bugs out there, but a search engine can be used to fix almost any problem you run into. The next time you receive an error message and don't know what to do, type in various words on the error window. It is almost certain that someone else has had the same problem. If an error window pops up saying some file is missing, type in the name of the file into Google. and you're likely to find a host of people that have had the same problem. You're also likely to stumble across a solution. Suppose you recently installed a new webcam, and the install program crashes before it finishes. Go to Google and type in the name of the webcam and the nature of the error. YouTube, for instance, is a goldmine of step-by-step visual tutorials. So, the next time you encounter a problem, don't call the manufacturer yet. Check the search engines like Google and YouTube instead of flipping out or reinventing the wheel. Another Google-related tip is open in new tab or window. By doing searches and right-clicking on the search matches, you may open the search match in another tab or window. This makes it much easier to quickly search large numbers of matches. Another search engine tip involves including a domain name along with the search words. Typing in Microsoft.com along with the desired search terms, you are more likely to get search results from Microsoft's website only. This is a great way to search a particular website in the case that that site doesn't have a search function. Speeding up your internet and browsing speed is also within the reach of those people who are willing to make a couple settings changes. By changing the DNS server you connect to is almost a surefire way to increase your internet browsing speed. Start by going to opendns.com and sign up for an account. In truth, however, an OpenDNS account is not necessary, because at the end of the day, you'll be doing a settings change on your own computer. Start by going back to the control panel, then network connections. Right-click on your default connection and go to properties. Select the Internet Protocol V4 and click properties. In the general tab, you will see use the following DNS server. Click on it and type in the following numbers. If opendns.com ever goes out of service, if only temporarily, return to this very window and simply check Obtain DNS Server Automatically. A program called TCP Optimizer can optimize your internet connection settings. Download it and run the program. A quick and easy way to use the program is to first get a general idea of your download speed. Search for sites that do internet speed tests, or just go to internetfrog.com and do a speed check. Notice the speed listed. Go to TCP Optimizer and approximate the download speed from the test. Then click Optimal. Then Apply Changes. A window will appear confirming your decision. There are also ways to increase the speed of your BitTorrent downloads. First, a few settings modifications in your BitTorrent client. Go to Options and then Preferences. In the menu to the left, click Connection. In the Ports for Incoming Connections edit box, type in a 5-digit number that's less than 65,000 and easy to remember. I'll use 22,222. Also make sure Enable UPnP port mapping and Enable NAYPnP port mapping are checked, while Randomize port at each start is unchecked. The Bandwidth menu is where global upload and download speeds are modified. In order to find out the recommended settings for global upload limit, you need to find out what your upload speed is. So, go to connection speed test sites like internetfrog.com and do a speed test. The number that results is likely to be measured in bits per second rather than bytes per second. Use the on-screen graph to find out the recommended global upload limit. My upload rate is 4.4 megabits per second. So, according to my graph, I should set my global upload rate to 180 kilobytes per second. In the BitTorrent menu, make sure Enable DHT Network, Enable DHT for New Torrents, Enable Local Peer Discovery, and Allow Incoming Legacy Connections are checked. Also make sure that Protocol Encryption is enabled. In the queuing menu, maximum number of active torrents should be at around 8, while maximum number of active downloads should be 4 to 6. In the advanced settings, change net.max half open to 50. In the disk cache settings menu, make sure reduce memory usage is unchecked. Now, if you have high-speed internet, you are likely to have a router. That router settings can be changed to slightly increase your BitTorrent downloads. First, go to the Start button, then Run. Type in CMD and hit Enter. A black command prompt window will appear, and in it, type ipconfig. Under Ethernet Adapter Local Area Connection, you will see two numbers of interest. The first is called Default Gateway, which, like myself, may be 192.168.1.1. The second number of interest is called the IPv4 address. In my case, my local IP address is 192.168.1.11. Yours is likely to look similar to the gateway address. Record both of these numbers. Then, open up a web browser of your choice and type in the default gateway address. Mine was 192.168.1.1. You will be prompted to enter in a username and password. Most of the time, the username is admin, and the password is admin. Unless someone has previously changed it, you may need to call your internet service provider to get past this window. Once inside your router settings, look for NAT, or port forwarding. You should now be in a position to add new entries to the list before you. Add an entry and call it BitTorrent. Set it to both TCP and UDP communications. Then enter in the local IP address you recorded. Mine was 192.168.1.11. Finally, enter in the port number you chose in the BitTorrent client. If you recall, I chose 22,222. Add the BitTorrent entry to the port forwarding list, and you're done. The first thing you need to do when upgrading or replacing devices in your computer is to know what kind of motherboard you have. In order to find out the model number of the motherboard, start by getting the model number of the computer. This is usually a 4 to 6 digit number that may be on the front or back of the computer. If you find many number series on your computer and you're not sure which is your computer's model number, start punching in those numbers into Google together with the computer's manufacturer. You will eventually discover which is the model number. Type the computer's model number and manufacturer into Google along with the word specification. It won't be long before you're looking at a page with details about your computer. The most critical of those details is the motherboard's model number. I, for instance, have a compact Presaria and my model number is SR5710Y. Details regarding your motherboard and compatible parts usually come in the documentation that came with your computer. I type all of this in, together with the word specifications. I discover that my computer has a motherboard whose model number is MCP61PM-HM. Your computer may also come with user's guides that can be found in the Start button option. Check for User's Guide or Documentation. After discovering your motherboard's model, type it into Google, together with the word specifications again. Here is the page from HP.com regarding my motherboard. This will tell you what kind of parts are compatible with your motherboard. To begin upgrading and replacing components of your computer, remove the computer's case or side panel. This usually involves unscrewing two conspicuous screws in the back of your computer. The removal of the computer's side panel exposes the internals of the PC. A couple words of caution in regards to PC repair. First, ensure the computer is unplugged. Secondly, Make flesh contact with the computer's metal chassis or frame every once in a while. This will ground out high voltage static electricity that may have been built up in your body. Static electricity can easily exceed 5,000 volts, which can damage the microscopic transistors within the computer circuitry. Because of this, it is important that you grab all circuit boards and cards on the sides, minimizing your contact with any metal part on the circuit. In order to upgrade or replace your RAM memory, first ensure that the RAM you choose is compatible with your motherboard. For instance, my motherboard uses DDR2 memory, and only three types of DDR2 memory are compatible with my motherboard. First, press down on the clips on both sides of the RAM cards. This will liberate and slightly raise the RAM. Then, grabbing from the sides, pull the cards out. The RAM is installed in the computer the same way, but in reverse. Notice the notches on the RAM card. Let these notches guide which way the RAM should be placed in the slot. If you are trying to install incompatible RAM, these notches will disallow the installation. To install a new video, audio, or Ethernet card into the computer, find the appropriate expansion slot that card will be installed into. There are three types of expansion slots these days: PCI, PCI Express, and AGP. You will typically find only a single PCI Express or AGP expansion slot, but you will often find many regular PCI slots. Video cards, especially the newer ones, tend to be designed for PCI Express slots, often called PCIe. Sound cards tend to plug into both PCIe and regular PCI slots, while most upgrade cards, like Ethernet cards, tend to plug into regular PCI slots. Open up an expansion slot in the back by unscrewing and removing a single metal guard. Then, lay the card into the slot, pressing evenly on both sides. You will feel the card snap into place. If you find yourself putting too much pressure on the card, make sure that the card and notches on the card are aligned to the slot. After installing the new card, the software that came with the upgrade should then be installed. This software contains the driver for your device. Many things like RAM and processors need no drivers after installation, while most other devices come with software and documentation. It is important to keep the documentation, and especially the software that comes with your newly acquired device. In regards to DVD players and hard drives, they are usually connected to the computer using SATA connectors or an IDE cable. SATA cables are narrow, while IDE cables are extremely wide. SATA cables are easily connected, but you may find yourself buying an extra SATA cable because not every device that requires them includes them. IDE cables, which you will mainly find on older computers, are a bit trickier. On the back of an IDE-oriented device, you'll find a series of jumper pins, usually labeled MA, SA, and CS. One of these three sets of jumper pins will have a jumper. A jumper is a small square object that can be removed and placed on any of the three sets of jumpers. The correct position of the jumper is relative to which plug on the IDE cable the device is connected to. On an IDE cable, you'll typically find three plugs. Two are closer together, while one is a bit isolated. This isolated plug is the one that connects to the motherboard. The plug in the middle is the slave, while the remaining plug is the master. So, if your new DVD burner is connected to the middle IDE plug, make sure the jumpers in the back of the device is on the two slave pins. Both IDE and SATA plugs have notches, ensuring they cannot be hooked up incorrectly. Freeware is software that is completely free. No demos, no trial versions, just free software. Many people foolishly buy software when there's a suitable freeware replacement. Although freeware doesn't tend to be rich in features, there's surely plenty of it. Here's a small list of freeware software titles that you may find useful. Virtual Dub, Any Video Converter, Freestar. These are video converters. These programs convert one video file format into another video file format. DVD Shrink, AVI to DVD. These two programs convert common video file formats into true DVD format. This allows you to convert any video file on the internet into DVD video that can be viewed on any DVD player. Audacity and Darkwave are two programs used to record and edit audio, along with create music. They can also be used to convert audio files into different formats. Winamp and VLC are two media players. Both are rich with features. Photoscape is an image editing utility. The aforementioned ImageBurn is an excellent disk burning program. Magic Disk, also called Magic ISO, is a program that mounts ISO files as virtual disk drives. This program is very useful when downloading software or video games on the internet. Open Office is a free and robust version of Microsoft's Office. 7-Zip is an archiving program that is used to open and create zip and RAR files. TeamViewer is a program that allows you to remotely control a distant computer over the internet. TrueCrypt, Trilogy EC Pro, and Cryptainer Free are encryption programs. Encryption scrambles your data using a password. These programs can make individual files and entire folders encrypted, along with encrypted emails and other communications. PC Tools Firewall is a robust firewall program. SpyBot and AdAware are two anti-spyware programs. I recommend SpyBot. PacketMon is a network monitoring program. It reports incoming and outgoing internet communications. Reg Cleaner is a utility that repairs registry errors, another common cause of computer slowdown. NetTools is an entire suite of utilities focused on internet and network functions. Highly recommended. Runalyzer. Brought to you by the people who made SpyBot, Runalyzer is similar to msconfig, allowing you to easily change your startup settings. So, let's review. Here are some points to remember. On the inside, the computer, you have a processor, motherboard, hard drive, disk drive, RAM, video, and audio cards. Every file on your computer has a name, path, extension, and file size, which is measured in bytes. The msconfig program and the control panel are two places where most of the computer settings can be found and modified. Codecs and Adobe Flash Player are necessary if you intend to watch video from websites and BitTorrent. Make sure the amount of data you attempt to write to a disk is below its maximum capacity. Make sure the disk is clean. BitTorrent rocks. Use it before the forces of darkness steal it and replace it with mind-numbing primetime television. A good way to locate even hard-to-find downloads is to type the name into a Google search engine, ending in torrent. Faster downloads have more seeds and peers. In order to create DVD movies that play in any DVD player, the video files must be VOB extensions and be contained in a video TS folder. Programs like AVI to DVD can convert the common video file format AVI into proper DVD video format. Never forget about the control button and the time it can save you. The functions of particular key combinations have for the most part been standardized, so they're worth memorizing. If you wish to do something with an object or item on screen, try to right-click it, and often a menu of options pertaining to the selected object will appear. Get yourself a firewall, antivirus, anti-spyware, and encryption software. Password-based encryption is the only way to ensure data security. Clean out the dust that has collected inside of the computer with a can of air duster or a vacuum cleaner that has attachments. This dust causes heat, which results in computer slowdown. Also, clean out the startup programs and services by using msconfig. Superfluous running startup programs slow down the computer and can even result in added security risk. Have a computer problem? Whether it's software or a hardware problem, check YouTube and Google. You are not likely to be the first to have any error out there. There are many tutorials on YouTube on countless subjects, and Google can access countless forums where questions have been answered. Toolbars cause slowdown in browsers. When buying new computer hardware, make sure the device is compatible with your motherboard. Make sure the new processor is compatible, or that you have the correct expansion slot for that video card, or that your motherboard can tolerate a particular kind of RAM. There's a freeware program for almost everything you want to do. Typing the kind of software you're looking for, followed by the word freeware, is a great place to start. Well, that's it. I hope you enjoyed this video, and I hope you feel a bit more comfortable fixing your own computer problems. I hope your computer is running a bit more smoothly, and I hope you won't go running to the Geek Squad for every little problem. I'd like to thank Joseph Lewis for his help on this project, and I'd also like to thank the many good-hearted programmers who make free software. Much love, labor, and light to you all. Take care, friends. Michael Wynn.